All right, we're starting off Brass Tacks with some breaking news that's coming in stateside, where there's been a 10-minute phone call between Prime Minister Modi and U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris. Remember, this is the first time there has been any formal communication between Prime Minister Modi and the newly elected U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris, of course, of Indian descent. This is the first time a phone call has happened. It's lasted for about 10 minutes, and we're given to understand that the phone call was initiated by the U.S. side, meaning by the U.S. Vice President's office. Maha Siddiqui has more details on this. Maha, is there any information? I know it's early days yet, but any information so far on what was discussed in this brief call between the Prime Minister and the U.S. Vice President?
This call was largely made and initiated by the United States and Vice President Kamala Harris, because the United States has now taken a call on how they are going to be sharing the surplus vaccines that they have with them. So there are about 80 million surplus vaccines that they'll have in some time to come, but they have given the allocation of the first 25 million, out of which a large chunk is going through COVAX to the countries, about 75% through COVAX. But the remaining 6 million vaccines will be shared between four countries, including India. This also includes Canada, Mexico, and Korea. It is after this decision was taken and the pressing need that India has at the current moment for vaccines that this call was initiated by the United States to give India information that a decision has been taken and that India should be ready to receive the ready vaccines. Now, we know that a large chunk of these vaccines are going to be the AstraZeneca vaccines, because there are about 60 million surplus AstraZeneca vaccines that America has, which is not approved in America, but the FDA was to take a call on whether it is up to the manufacturing standard to be shared with other countries. So I guess that call has been made. 20 million vaccines are those that have been approved in America, for instance, Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson, but they are surplus vaccines, so America is willing to share those as well. So the call was specifically made with regards to how the vaccines will be shared. And of course, America has stepped up after there was the devastation we saw in the second wave that hit India badly. And America has been in touch at the official level over the aid that had that they had as well sent, and also the Global Task Force, which is a group of American companies that have also been helping India.
All right. Thanks very much for that, Maha Siddiqui. So this 10-minute telephone conversation between the U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris and Prime Minister Narendra Modi, conveying this decision that about 6 million vaccines will be made available to a bunch of countries, including India. Meanwhile, talking about the second wave, which may be in a decline, at least certainly in large parts of the country, in Delhi, in Maharashtra, in many states, the second wave is on the decline. And there's only one way to ensure that there are no more waves, and that is to vaccinate every adult in this country. And to that end, the government of India has made a very big promise to vaccinate all adult Indians. That's about almost 100 crore of them, for which 216 crore vaccine doses will be made available through to the end of the year. That means by December, there will be 216 crore vaccines. Jabs approved abroad can be brought into India. Import licenses will be approved in a matter of a day or two. And also the indemnity clause will be waived off for companies like Pfizer and Moderna. But here is where it gets interesting, because over 94 crore citizens need to be vaccinated. 94 crore citizens are eligible to get the vaccine, but only over 22 crore have been vaccinated till the 2nd of June, of which about 17.5 crore have got the first dose. And if you were to look at the percentage of the population or the number of people who've got fully inoculated both the doses of either Covishield or Covaxin, that is under 5 crores, just about 4.5 crore people across the country who have been fully vaccinated. Now, to meet the government's target, we need an average of 15 crore vaccinations every single month. Right now, we're barely touching about 5 to 6 crores or so. So we need a 3 times exponential jump, as it were. This is while the shortage of vaccines and trained manpower, there's also vaccine hesitancy in many parts of rural India. There is inadequate infrastructure to store and transport some of these foreign jabs. And of course, if there were to be, God forbid, a third wave, then that would also potentially pose some roadblocks. Given this scenario, Are we on track to inoculate over 100 crore people, to have 216 crore vaccine doses out by December, or is that just a tall promise? Joining us on the talking point this evening, Aparajita Sarangi is a BJP Member of Parliament. We have Rohan Gupta, Congress Party spokesperson and social media head. Vishal Tiwari is senior advocate of the Supreme Court of India. And Ashutosh Garg is a former board member of Gavi and the founder of Guardian Pharmacy. Aparajita Sarangi, I'll start with you. I'll start with the indemnity clause conversation, because that seems to have now thrown a big spanner in the works. For the longest time, Pfizer and Moderna and other foreign vaccine manufacturers wanted indemnity waived off. The government was not very keen on that. But now, finally, they have decided to waive off indemnity, so much so that the Indian manufacturers, both Serum and Bharat Biotech, are saying, why are you waiving it off only for foreign manufacturers? What about us? What about us having to spend out of our pocket for insurance costs?
A very good evening. At the outset, let me tell you that we will stand by our commitment. We would be vaccinating around 100 crore people with two doses. And that's why the Prime Minister came before the nation and submitted his blueprint. He said very candidly that there would be 216 crore vaccine doses by 31st of December. Now, there is absolutely no reason for any kind of cynicism at this hour. We demand that all the people in the opposition, on wherever they are, they should be supporting the government. We would be doing that. And the government is in dialogue with all, including, as you said, including Pfizer and Moderna. And ultimately, you know, the regulatory relaxations
you say there should
come.
Not be any
we are
cynicism.
Talking of the indemnity
waiver. Do you know how many vaccine jabs we've had in the month of May?
I understand. I'm coming to that. Please give me some time. In the month of May, 7.9 crore vaccine doses have been sent to the states and the union territories. And let me tell you that it would be 12 crore vaccine doses in this month, the current month, June. And as you said in your opening remarks, we need to go to 15 crore. Now, let me tell you, we are into different kinds of sourcing. We are looking at only Bharat Biotech. We are looking at only Serum. Sputnik is coming. Sputnik would be bringing 10 crore very soon. 10 crore vaccine jabs very soon. The RDIF and Panacea Biotech, they would be the partners of Sputnik. They would be launching Sputnik in our country. Now, as far as Covishield is concerned, it would be 10 crore vaccine doses per month very soon. In the next 1 or 2 months, it would come. As far as Covaxin is concerned, we would be moving from 3.32 crore vaccine doses in July to 7.82 crore vaccine doses in August.
Ma'am, these are all figures. Hang on one second. These are all figures you're bandying about. But the point is, right now, Serum barely makes 6 crore vaccines. Covaxin, on the other hand, barely makes 2 crore vaccines. This is great to come on a television show and say, you know, we'll have 200 crore vaccines by the end of December.
No, it's not on the television channel.
No, please show us. Show us where the orders are, ma'am. Have orders been placed? I'm asking you, have you placed orders for 216 crore vaccines? Has the government of India or state governments or private entities placed orders? Show me the orders.
We are not talking only on the television channel. We are talking the same language in the Supreme Court. And when we go to the Supreme Court, definitely we would say the truth and we would be filing an affidavit in the next 15 days. You are aware of that. There are many questions that have been raised by the Honorable Supreme Court. We respect those questions and we would be answering all questions. One question certainly is that whether you would be able to inoculate or vaccinate about 100 crore people, 216 crore doses would be produced or not. We are coming up with a statement.
Okay.
It would be part of the affidavit. The matter is sub judice. And let me tell you that there are states. See, ultimately, there are 94 crore people.
We will see. We will see what is mentioned in that affidavit. It's a sworn document. And you are bound. You are bound by that sworn document. But may I also remind you, the same Supreme Court that you referred to yesterday called the vaccination policy of the government of India arbitrary and irrational. But let me go to Rohan Gupta, and I'm sorry to say this, Rohan Gupta, neither is the behavior of the opposition particularly rational, because it is the opposition states, and I clearly remember this, chief ministers from Mr. Arvind Kejriwal to Mamata Banerjee all said, why should have center have monopoly? Why should center have monopoly? Free it up. We will go to the market. We will procure. And then a month down the line, all of y'all are coming back tail between your legs, realizing that no international company wants to sell to you. They all want to deal with the
Zaka.
Central government. Now we're back to square one.
Zaka, I just heard BJP spokesperson talking about the tall promise of this government and saying that nobody can criticize that. We have seen this government's track record in last 1 year, where they declared the win over Corona after first round. They declared that, okay, we will help 136 countries. So absolutely, Supreme Court was very, very clear in its comment that please show us the roadmap. When they are saying that 216 crore vaccines will be given or will be procured or people will be inoculated, where is the plan? I have done simple mathematics. Before that, I'll go to the comment of Supreme Court about the digital divide. Only 4% of our rural population has access to computer and 23% of people in urban area. How do you expect people to register on COVID? So the base of the whole vaccination program, Supreme Court has already questioned that. If you are depending on the digital platform,
sir,
that is not
realistic.
All
of those are valid points. I am not denying any of that.
Coming
but can
to
you
Zaka,
please answer my question?
Did not Uddhav Thackeray come out and say, let me procure vaccines?
Did not Arvind Kejriwal say that? Did not Mamata Banerjee say that?
Yeah.
Please answer that question, sir. Yes, sir.
Let me complete.
Please answer the question, please.
If you see the track record of this government from January, only 1.5 crore vaccines were ordered and it was given to frontline workers because they never anticipated the second round. Obviously, states were jittery. The way second wave was coming, states were jittery and they told government, please involve us in anything. It was never said that you change the policy and give it independently to the state. No. Only thing is, involve the states in the decision making so that we come to a decision where it is win-win for all. You tell me, Zaka, is it logical for government to give states vaccine at 600 rupees, the same vaccine which is bought by 175? Which state will accept that? Apart from that, the buying power of state is not going
Sir,
to be the same as central.
The same
so the
states,
is, nobody
are, there
said,
are letters
Zaka,
written
let
by
complete.
Opposition
Zaka,
chief
please
ministers
let me
to the center saying, please allow
please
us to procure vaccines.
Nobody,
as many as
told,
10 states went
told,
to the international
see,
market and asked for vaccines
here,
and no foreign company wants to deal with states. Now
said,
the states are coming back and saying, please
said,
give
Zaka,
us free vaccines.
Let me complete, Zaka. This is not the way. You allow BJP spokesperson
sir,
to complete. Please
sir,
let me complete.
Sir, sir,
no, you
sir,
are speaking
there
in
is a letter
Zaka.
By Uddhav Thackeray.
You let me complete.
No, no, there is a letter by Uddhav Thackeray. Are you denying that? Are you denying? Are you denying? Are you denying? Rohan Saab. Rohan Saab. Okay.
No, I will not allow. You allow me the full time.
Simple question.
And I, at the end
you
of
said,
my
you
thing,
said no
if
chief
you don't
minister
get
has
answer,
written.
You speak in between, Zaka.
You said,
no,
you
this
said,
is not that way. No.
No, no.
You, allow
you said no chief minister. No chief
Even
minister has written.
Lying, you allow
I am asking
speak.
You. Uddhav Thackeray did not write. Arvind Kejriwal did not
no.
write. No,
no,
I interrupted the BJP
the
spokesperson
you
too.
To allow me to
you, I'm sure you heard when I told the BJP spokesperson that
you
are making tall promises. I interrupted
the
BJP spokesperson as much as I interrupted you. Because both of
you
all are only interested in rhetoric.
No,
no, you don't have any answers, Mr. Gupta. I'm sorry. You are not giving any answers to the question I'm asking you. You are only indulging in political rhetoric, just like the BJP spokesperson is. No, I'm sorry. Please, I'm giving, I am telling both the spokespersons. This is not the show for rhetoric. This is not the show for rhetoric. This is not the time for rhetoric.
The way we are speaking.
Are sir, if you have an answer to my question, please answer. I give you 30 seconds more. If you do not have an answer, I am going on to the other guest. Please.
You will get my answer. Please allow me 30 seconds.
Yes.
So, Zaka,
yes.
My point is very
yes.
clear. The way this government was totally failing on the vaccination policy, state only told, please involve us in everything so that we ensure that the distribution is proper. Why they kept it centrally? Then why they procured vaccine centrally on the round one? Why they didn't allow Serum or other biotech to be going to the states directly? Why there is a differential pricing? Nobody said that. They should have kept the same pricing. There is absolutely no issue. Where is the vaccine? Where are the vaccines? We are talking about 216 crore vaccines.
Okay, 30 seconds over. States went and directly tried to procure. No, states went and directly tried to procure. What happened that? What happened after that, Rohan Gupta? No, what happened after that? Did any state manage to get? Did they manage to get? Delhi chief minister came on 23rd of April. No, let me tell our viewers, please. Delhi chief minister came on TV 23rd of April and said, we have placed 1.34 crore vaccine orders. You know, in vaccine centers in Delhi are shut. Vaccine centers in the national capital are shut. because neither state nor center could procure vaccine. Come on, please.
The opposition parties, no, they will not.
Mr. Vishal Tiwari and Mr. Ashutosh Garg, I want to move away from the political spokespersons because I'm sure the people of this country are also sick and tired of all of this nonsensical rhetoric that we've heard from our political parties. Oh, I will procure. Oh, center cannot procure. Center said states shouldn't go and procure. States then go and ask the international market. Nobody wants to deal with the states. This back and forth has been going on for the better part of the last 1 month, and people are dying and people are not getting vaccinated. That's the reality of this country. Vishal Tiwari, I want to come back to where I started, and unfortunately, you know, the BJP spokesperson also did not give me an answer on this. The indemnity business. Now that the government has said that they are willing to waive off indemnity for both Pfizer, Moderna and other foreign vaccines, Indian manufacturers are coming out and asking what would on the face of it seem legitimate questions. Why are you waiving off indemnity only for them? Why not for us? Is it a legitimate argument? Or do you believe that you can't compare Indian manufacturers of vaccine to foreign manufacturers? It's apples and oranges.
The political complications are on one side and legal complications are on the other side. So now the biggest obstacle was that indemnity bond, which the Pfizer and other company was seeking from the government of India. So they want the assurance that they shall be free from any kind of legal cases or any legal allegations. Suppose if any kind of side effects takes place after their vaccination, so they shall not be questioned. Now it has become a very, we have to supply the vaccines and we are seeking help of the foreign vaccines, Pfizer and other one also. So now government has to, it has to go down. Go down means it has to make a compromise so that their Indian citizens should be vaccinated. And as we are seeing that there were several disputes also that why states are not allowed or why states are not seeking vaccinations, why they are not demanding the vaccines from the other countries. And the states were saying that why center is not making them available. So this question was also raised before the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said that you have to make a uniform policy so that all the citizens shall get the vaccines without any kind of obstacle and without any kind of these complications. So indemnity, as per to Section 124 of the Contract Act, a party can demand indemnity that it shall not be questioned or it shall remain safe from any kind of legal complications if they arise.
All right.
So government, so after hearing was made, when the Supreme Court was making queries about this on the 31st of the May, when this petition was dismissed, and other petitions, so it was asking the government that you have to approach. You have to approach means you have to formulate a policy for the entire nation. You cannot say that a particular state shall also approach some kind of things or it shall also do. So I think that government has now waived off this indemnity so that the citizens can be benefited more easily. No obstacles shall come in the way.
Yeah, okay. I get that. Let me also ask Ashu Garg. Ashu, you're in the business of, you know, medicines and pharmacies and so on. You were also a member of Gavi. Help us understand, what is the nub of the problem here? Yes, we were having vaccination going as per a pre-decided plan with senior citizens first, and sorry, healthcare workers and frontline workers first, and then senior citizens, and then 45 plus. All of a sudden, as the second wave sort of came up, states, and you wouldn't fault them for doing it, saying that, look, the bulk of the spreaders seem to be the young population, so we should give priority to the young population to be vaccinated. If center cannot find those vaccines, allow us to go ahead and procure those vaccines. So the center liberalized the policy. And now it turns out the states are not getting vaccines either from foreign manufacturers or from domestic manufacturers because there simply isn't enough supply. And in this back and forth between center and state, we are inoculating 20 lakh people, 25 lakh people, on good days, 30 lakh people, which is a fraction of where we should be on a daily basis if we hope to get everybody in this country, every adult in this country vaccinated by the end of the year. So please, you know, put the finger on where the problem is. What went wrong?
So, Zaka, thank you very much. I was on your show a few weeks ago when you were talking global tenders, and I had very categorically said the only way vaccines can be procured is through a global tender done by the center, not by 28 states and 8 union territories. And some people had got upset about it. I'd also said Gavi is handling the COVAX facility. There are a handful of manufacturers. Let's all talk to them. Prices are pre-agreed. Let's just do an agreement. And I'd also mentioned that let us not finesse the exact numbers if we get 100 million extra vaccines, so be it, because we definitely need far more vaccines than we can currently handle. But I think there are other challenges. You know, I don't have the ability to second guess the numbers, but I just hope there is enough wisdom in the government where we under promise and over deliver. But you know, there are other challenges that we are beginning to see, even with the 3.5 lakh vaccines per day. What are our delivery strategies? You know, do we have the people to be able to deliver 100 crore vaccines to our people? I mean, you know, for the pulse polio vaccine, which are drops, of course, not injections, pharmacies were opened up. We've got 800,000 pharmacies, even more pharmacists. They can all give injections. We've got primary health centers. We've got sub centers. We've got retired medical practitioners. You know, in the last few weeks, the Resident Welfare Associations are doing an amazing job. You know, someone has to start corralling all of them into a powerhouse that India needs. I mean, we need to save lives and livelihoods. And what is our biggest challenge going to be? Is our cold chain and our logistics strong enough to be able to deliver such large number of vaccines? We spoke about wastage a few days ago on CNN News 18, and there are states which have got, you know, horrendous wastage figures. When the numbers increase, can you imagine what's going to happen if some state has got a 30% wastage, which means one out of three people are not getting vaccine? Well, you know, the other big challenge is what about record keeping? You know, the COVID app, the app is beginning to fall apart. You know, if it's going to be opened up to such large numbers, how do I ensure that I have my certificate? What is our plan B if the vaccine manufacturers don't deliver? I mean, that's the kind of healthy debate we need, and not a postmortem by every political party every time saying you did this and I didn't do this.
I want to go back to the political spokespersons, and I've got, you know, less, you know, 30 seconds each for both Aparajita Sarang and Rohan Gupta. Let's leave the politics aside. Let's kindly, for God's sake, leave the rhetoric aside. I'm asking a simple question, Aparajita Sarangi. If we need to inoculate 100 crore people by the end of the year, Ashu Garg is 100% right. We cannot be depending just on hospitals. We need to open it up to our pharmacies. We need to have it in our primary healthcare centers. We need to tie up with schools and universities, and basically bring in a large number of platforms where people can easily go and access the vaccine. Will you please look into this? Is this something of consideration in the government right now?
Now, I would be very emphatically saying that the central government is not into rhetoric. The Bharatiya Janata Party is not into rhetoric. We are into action. You are seeing it every day, the way, you know, all of us are working hard and trying to control. Now, as far as the falling apart of COVID platform is concerned and, you know, accessing all is concerned, let me tell you that we have ANMs, we have ASHA workers, we have Anganwadi workers, we have medical personnel, we have people all across, you know, the Women and Child Development Department and the Health and Family Welfare Department and all other field level personnel are working in 7 lakh villages of the country. So all these people would be mobilized if we have to generate awareness if it comes to that. So when we intend to vaccinate all, we intend to do so. We stand by our commitment. And just give me 1 minute, 30 seconds, Jaka.
I don't have a minute, ma'am.
Yes, Bharat Biotech has also agreed to allow a large number of companies to manufacture its vaccine. So let me tell you, as far as the indemnity clause is concerned, the third part, just about 10 seconds. The indemnity clause, yes, we have arrived at an in-principle consensus with Pfizer, though there has been no agreement as such so far. The other companies have also come and they have also said, why not we? But I tell you, this is quite premature on our part to say anything. We are into agreement. We are into dialogues at this juncture.
We would be considering the demands. Rohan, I'll give you the final word. 30 seconds. Rohan Gupta, 30 seconds. Will the states at least finally, I believe Jagan Mohan Reddy, the Andhra chief minister, has today written a letter to all chief ministers, including to the Kerala chief minister, to whom he addressed it and said, let's at least finally now accept that vaccine procurement has to be centralized. States cannot procure vaccine.
Zaka, first of all, nobody questioned.
Rohan.
And number two, now we are talking about government's plan to inoculate 108 crore people. If you have to give first dose to the people in next 3-4 months, you will need 80 crore vaccines. Where are they? Number one. How will people register? Number two, and where is the infrastructure, as you rightly told? So if government has announced this plan, there has to be action on ground. Because otherwise, it is only on paper. How will you get 80 crore vaccines in next 4 months? There is no supply. The domestic manufacturers, you rightly said, they have said in month of June, they will supply only 12 crore vaccines. If you just, you know, put 3 months, after 3 months, you'll require 12 months. I've just done that calculation. On average, you'll require 30, 35 crore vaccines in a month. Number one, where are the vaccines? How the people will register? There is a digital divide. And where is the infrastructure? That is what I'm saying. And answering your first point about the procurement, we never said that procurement has to be decentralized. It's only about the distribution, because central government should have procured vaccine at central level and distributed it to the state government at a universal uniform price.
Okay.
There was
okay.
absolutely no question.
All right. I'm completely out of time. Thank you very much, Rohan Gupta, Aparajita Sarangi, Ashutosh Garg, and Mr. Tiwari for joining us. I'm going to the other big story, and that, of course, is the Choksi hearing that's happening in the Dominican court. It's now been adjourned. We're given to understand this is in the extradition case. Till the next hearing, Mehul Choksi will continue to be on Dominican soil. In fact, both sides have also filed submissions appealing for another date. Now, another court, a magistrate court in Dominica, which had denied bail to Choksi in connection with his illegal entry into the country, that matter will be taken up on the 14th. Let me go to Ashish Maheshi. Ashish, very quickly, what happened in court today?
Well, in fact, you know, both the sides put up their case. It was heard, but ultimately, the delaying tactics of Choksi's lawyers is actually working, and that is why, at least till the 1st of July, it seems to be that the next hearing won't happen, and that is why, you know, what we are seeing is that Mehul Choksi is going to stay at least till the 1st of July in Antigua. But in the magistrate court, which is supposed to hear on the 14th, we can expect that, you know, the plea, which is basically regarding his, illegal detention, or you can say can you hear me, Zaka?
Yeah, I'm afraid I'm out of time, but thank you very much, Ashish, for joining us and giving us your thoughts and perspectives. We'll be on top of that story. Thanks very much for tuning in. I'll catch you again tomorrow night.